What's going on, AJ?
Hey, what's up, man? Scott?
Yep.
Hey, man, how you doing?
Good. Yeah, so I just wanted to, I know you're busy, so if you just want to get right into it, we'll get going.
Yeah, man, thanks for being persistent, not giving up hope.
Yeah. So just basically, you know, talking about your career and everything, I mean, I just wanted to ask you, you know, being a young kid and, you know, going through the minor league system for you, I mean, we've had a bunch of other guys come on, but I mean, it seems like you were very persistent also, you know, your career. For you, I mean, how did it, you know, feel making the decision to go into the draft and, you know, take the selection and go with it rather than, you know, maybe choosing a different path or, you know, waiting a year or two?
Yeah, good question. I'm sorry if I'm out of breath. I'm got to run into a little bike ride, but yeah, it was interesting for me because high school, I played a lot of third base in high school. I pitched here and there, pretty much. I probably pitched a little bit more in summer than I did in high school, but not a lot. So my decision was tough. See, I didn't know whether to go to college and go hit or go professional and then do something I've really never done before. I mean, I threw hard as a kid, but that's kind of all I did. You know, I never really was a pitcher. So it was a tough call on my part. But I did. I felt like I would get a little better coaching from a professional standpoint, from me not being on the mound as much as opposed to going to college. So took that route, and it was not an easy route. My first couple of years, a lot of the guys that I got drafted with, a lot of guys that I played with, bolted up. You know, they bolted up the line. These guys were 12-1 out of high school, you know, 13-2 out of high school, you know, whatever their record were the senior year. You know, my senior year record was, I think, like 3-0. You know, maybe I threw three games. So I went up one by one. You know, they bolted up, and I'm just, you know, I'm creeping up. I'm like, I ain't never going to get this. These guys are studs, you know. I mean, yeah, I throw hard, but it's hitting the backstop, you know, and it's going everywhere. But, like, one of those guys made it, you know, through my first 3 years in minor leagues. Not another one of them made it to the big leagues. And I got traded in 97 to the Marlins. Light went off, and it kind of just everything else in the rearview mirror.
And for you, you know, making that transition, you know, talking about playing third base and stuff, I mean, I'm sure scouts were kind of leaning towards, you know, drafting you as a pitcher. But, I mean, was that something that you contemplated, you know, maybe sticking with third base? You know, your career would obviously have been different. But, I mean, for you, I mean, were you comfortable in the fact of transitioning, you know, into a full-time pitcher, you know, and skipping college and going straight to the pros with that?
I was not comfortable at the time, but it became comfortable. It was something new for me. It wasn't something I did often, you know.
And for you, you know, obviously getting into the pros, I'm curious for you, throwing that no-hitter, we've had a few other guys, you know, come on, you know, with similar kind of, you know, no-hitters and stuff like that. For you, I'm curious because I believe it was 9 walks in that game. I mean, for you, going through that, but, you know, giving up all those walks, I mean, I'm sure there was kind of an uneasy feeling that for you, you know, maybe throwing the no-hitter, but at the same time, you know, giving up all those walks. I'm curious for you, I mean, did you feel comfortable that game? That it was just kind of a fluke with all the walks? I mean, how did that go for you, you know, just looking back on, you know, one of your memorable starts, I'm sure.
Well, yeah, it was. You know, it was going everywhere, basically. And you know what? I always meant the rest of my career. You know, I'm not going to lie. I didn't try, but I went out with the mindset of throwing a no-hitter every time, especially after I threw one that was so ugly because I wanted to throw a cleaner one, you know. But then you talk to the guys I play with, they're like, man, no-hitter's a no-hitter. I'm like, is it? I mean, basically, bottom line is it is. But, you know, the crazy stat, Kyle, about that game is I threw 128 pitches that game. I threw 121 fastballs. I threw probably 119 two-seamers, and it was just going left, right, up, down. I mean, Charles Johnson was my catcher at the time, and every time it was just sinker, 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 and he's like, I didn't know where it was going, but I knew it had a lot of movement, and it was working. And funny story about that, he came out in the 6th inning, so I think it was a mound chat, maybe the 7th, and he had no idea we had no hitter going, because every inning we had a guy on second base because of walks. So he's like, man, it kind of all is, I don't regret throwing it, heck no, I'm not embarrassed of it, heck no, but I wouldn't mind throwing a cleaner one, you
Yeah. And for you, you know, talking about the accuracy stuff, I'm curious for you, were you always kind of uneasy with the fact of, you know, you were just mentioning you didn't know where it was going sometimes. I mean, for you, you know, doing that, and even, you know, I'm sure one of the memorable moments that, you know, people remember too is, you know, you throwing it and, you know, hitting through the, I believe it was the back windshield of the car. For you doing that, I mean, just, is that something that you look back on, you know, just with the kind of the control stuff and maybe, you know, wish
you... Can you imagine if I did that in today's game?
I know, yeah, for you...
I'd be the worst person in America.
For you doing that, I'm curious, I mean, how, I mean, I'm just kind of shocked at that because, you know, the car was moving and everything. For you doing that, I mean, was it completely unintentional? I mean, how did that go for you?
Well,
I mean...
happened, of course I said slip, you know, I didn't think, but I didn't really like the fact of a vehicle being on the field, especially when pitchers were trying to warm up. Yeah. And it just seemed like, and I don't know if it's true or not, but it just seemed like every time I was on them down, that thing truck go by, you know, and I'm like, sure, I'm a pro and I'm a baseball player and I shouldn't even see that truck, you know, I get it. But I used to bounce it off the ground, Kyle, and hit the back fender up, you know, and it makes loud noise, like don't. And finally, two of the veteran guys, you know, this is my second year in the big league. So they're like, look, kid, if you're going to hit it and get over with, because we're tired of seeing it. I was like, oh, dad, what's that mean? So I hit it. You know, yeah. I hit it. I didn't think about it. It's hilarious, don't get me wrong, but if I had to go all over again, I would not do that. We had a 15-20 minute delay for them to clean up the glass behind home plate. We had a rookie third baseman that was probably like, what is going on here? You know, my catcher frames it, though. That's the best part of the whole video, you know. Redmond just sticks it on the outside corner, like, what y'all talking about, man? That's a strike. But it looked worse because they knew it was happening. Every other time I did it was directly behind the catcher, so it just looked like it got away from me. But as I came out of my turn, I realized that truck had slowed down. Like, you could see the light, the brake lights. I was like, oh, crap. And I'd already been committed, so that's why I looked so bad, because I just had to make a direct left, and it just went, you know, Went even near the back of the home plate. So, but crazy. But no, I think I got my control of my velocity went down. You know, I was a young, stubborn kid, probably because I threw hard. If I would have known more or paid attention more like I did in my last, you know, 8-10 years of my career early on, things might have been different. But dude, I threw hard, you know, sometimes triple digits. And if one of those guys, you know, if Jim Edmonds, Larry Walker, Barry Bonds, Andrew Jones, if one of them fouled one off, I was going to throw it harder because he fouled it off. You know, it was just how I was brought up. I wasn't a pitcher. I was a thrower. And I think as my career got on, later in my career, I realized that I could do both. So.
Yeah. And for you, I'm curious also, more with kind of the more on the serious note, for you just, you know, going to New York in 2009, I'm curious for you, you know, the Yankees obviously having kind of a down year in 2008, and then, you know, in 2009, you know, bringing in a bunch of, you know, studs, including yourself, just what, you know, CeCe, Sabathia, Mark Teixeira. I mean, how good did you guys know you were at the time, you know, even during spring training and, you know, during the season leading up to, you know, that great postseason run where, I mean, it just seemed like it was destined for you guys to, you know, eventually win it, just with all the guys on that team.
Yeah, it sure did, didn't it? I mean, from the get-go, it seemed like it. You know, that was probably one of the best teams, if not the best team I've ever been a part of. And you know what? It was Posada, it was Jeter, it was Mo, it was Alex, and it was Andy. You know, it was them that allowed but, you know, they brought all these new guys in, and it was like we'd been there already. You know, it wasn't, you know, weird. It wasn't like, oh, man, these are guys we stayed last year playing. You know, none of that stuff. It was just like we belong there. And the clubhouse is perfect. You know, we had Johnny Damon, Swisher, you know, me and CC. We pretty much gave it to anybody, you know what I mean? Like, whether it was Alex or Jeet, you know, we kind of just – and you realize that these guys are human, man. Like, they're just as funny and just as silly and just as, you know, as any of the other guys. But come game time, it's game time. And – it was a special season, no doubt, and I think it's really cool that we were able to christen that stadium the way we did, for sure.
And for you, you know, going through that, I'm curious, you know, in the World Series, and I know people say, you know, it's every start, you know, it's treated the same and stuff, but getting that opportunity to, you know, pitch, I know you pitched in a few other postseason games as well, but, you know, specifically the World Series, I mean, is there anything that you did differently, you know, leading up to that? I know people say, you know, being a professional, I know you mentioned that before, and, you know, treating it all the same. But, I mean, there's got to be a different mindset, you know, going into a game like that. I mean, can you just look back on that and kind of, you know, what was your mindset?
There's nervousness no matter what, you know. And I think if there's not, you're not human. You know, maybe Junior and them guys weren't human because I never saw them act like they were nervous. Maybe because they thought they knew we were going to win, you know. But I have pitched in a handful of games. That game was different for some reason, and I wish I knew why. I don't know if it's because of the Cliff Lee, you know, shoving that first game and then another kid from Arkansas coming back, or if it was Alicia Keys in the right field singing the song while I'm warming up. I don't know, but I just seemed a little more relaxed that game than any other game I pitched in the postseason. And I came out of the locker room, you know, I remember seeing my kids at the time, shoot, they were probably 4-6. Sad as can be, you know, they lost game one, even though they're like, well, what's going on? And I just remember looking down at AJ, and I remember saying, hey, man, Dad's got this, man. We're going to be all right. And I don't ever remember saying that. You know, St. Louis game with Pittsburgh, I was a little nervous because they hadn't been there in a while, and I wanted to do really good, you know. And second time against Philly, you know, they hit me up early. We ended up winning that game, I think. But it was just weird. That second game was just like, you know, that's why I'm here. You know, this is why, you know, New York brought me here, and let's just go do it. So that one game, I wasn't human, you know, and I'll admit it. I was not nervous. Night four, warming up. I couldn't tell you why. Maybe it was the atmosphere, the guys. But it's something different, man. Those games they're not like any other games, you know, no chance.
And, you know, going through that, you know, I know you had, you know, the opportunity to, you know, watch, you know, and I believe it was 03 with the Marlins. I know you were injured at the time, but, you know, getting that, you know, kind of atmosphere experience and, you know, being an older guy. I mean, do you think the experience of, you know, being an older guy in that situation helped you rather than maybe being a 22-year-old, you know, fresh off, you know, the minor leagues? I mean, how much do you think that helped you, especially in the spotlight of New York, you know, going there at an older age rather than, you know, starting there as a young kid?
Well, I think it played a big part of it. I think it played a big part of my struggles too as well, Kyle. I think if I was a younger kid dealing with what I dealt with in 10 and 11, who knows what I might have said or I might have done, you know. But I grew up a lot. You know, I got around the right people. And I think watching them being in that World Series and seeing how the guys in 03 handled themselves. I mean, we came into New York huge underdogs, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then what was it, 4 pitches in, we're leading 1-0, and it was like you could hear a mouse dribble, you know, scurrying around or a pin drop in that stadium. It was just crazy. But I think definitely the bumps and the bruises along the way and me being around the right people as far as Holiday and coming to New York, CC, and just seeing how people react differently, I think it helped out a lot being a little further on in my career for sure.
And, you know, coming towards the end of your career, I'm curious, you know, getting into the All-Star game in 2015, you know,
finally.
Huh?
Sorry, I said finally.
Oh, yeah, right. I know, and you had a few other good, you know, seasons too where, you know, you think you would have made it. But, you know, in 2015, you know, getting that All-Star game and, you know, kind of, you know, that being the end of your career after the end of the 2015 season. I mean, were you going into that season, you know, with the mindset of this was going to be it? I mean, was there anything specific that made you, you know, kind of hang it up at that point? I know you were 38 at the time and, you know, you had a family. But, I mean, what was that like having to, you know, kind of hang up, you know, the game from yourself? Just, you know, I'm sure playing it all your life and having to give it up at that point.
Getting tough. It was just getting tough to, you know, and I'll quote what again the great lefty Pettit said, you know, it wasn't hard to pitch. You know, I felt great pitching, but those 4 days trying to get ready to pitch was a lot different, you know, later on than early in my career. So I went on the DL, I believe, in 13, and I had some issues in the arm here and there, but nothing bad, but enough where I needed to be like, look, I'm good. You know, nothing else I need to do. I pitched, you know, 17 years. I think my mindset basically more than anything was going back to Pittsburgh. I wanted to end on a strong note. If I hadn't taken it all back, I might have signed. I probably should have signed a long-term deal with Pittsburgh and done more negotiating with them. But then again, I got to go to Philly. I got to meet and play against a lot of guys that I grew up playing with in Florida. That was really awesome. But I think me getting a chance to go back to right back to Pittsburgh after that season, show them how much I missed them, show the team how much I want to be back there. And you know what? I didn't really worry about me. I didn't really worry about my numbers. I didn't really worry about anything except being good for this city and this team and these guys now that I'm back. And I think things just worked out where I was able to enjoy my first All-Star game on my way out. So it was pretty cool.
And, you know, obviously playing, you know, at the later 90s, and then, you know, ending in 2015, I'm curious for you because we've had a lot of guys on here that, you know, have been older, kind of out of the game like yourself, like Johnny Gomes and other guys like that. And then, you know, we have some younger guys coming on and talking about just the technology aspect of the game. I'm sure in 99, you know, there's very, you know, little in the fact of that. And in 2015, I'm sure there was, you know, a lot more than you ever expected. I mean, just talking to you, it seems like, you know, the technology wasn't really a part of kind of your strategy going into the game. I know you mentioned, you know, just being a thrower, you know, the majority of the time. I mean, for you, was technology just an afterthought, you know, even later on in your career, and you just focus on more of just throwing rather than, you know, worrying about kind of the outside stuff that maybe other guys look to help them improve more?
No, I think technology, I think some people can be overloaded on it. I think I was one of those guys. So I started using it more later in my career to see the positive in everything. So example for that is if I got it handed to me for two innings and that's as far as I went, I'm not going back and watching that game. I just pitched it, Kyle. I know what happened, right? So yeah. I'm going to use technology. I'm going to go watch a good game. I'm going to go watch last time I pitched against those guys when I succeeded and I saw what I did the right way. I don't want to go back and watch what I just did and just keep looking at negative. I mean, I get it. My arm slot was down. I hung a few pitches, maybe some wrong pitches, whatever. I was there. But I use technology for positive. I used to have third strike swing and misses. I have videos put together with that with some of my music. So you just continually see yourself doing right. Of course, those pitches leading up to that really matter. But, you know, you see yourself doing right. And we didn't have a lot of that early on. And I never wanted to be overloaded. So I didn't want to be on the mound and be like, okay, I got you two count. Oh, what that chart say?
Yeah.
I'm supposed to throw a red. What am I supposed to do here? You know, never, because I always felt like you have to go with your gut no matter what. Now, it's good to know some of that stuff. So when I was in Pittsburgh, I really started kind of to buy into it. Never met with a pitcher and catcher, you know, my whole career. And I didn't even do it in Pittsburgh. I mean, I was a two-pitcher. It's not hard to call that game, you know. But I started to get the sheets of hitters' tendencies. Like, not so much every little detail, but just – you know, hey, is this guy jump on the first pitch? Hey, is this guy swing 3-0? You know, more so that lines than anything else. But as far as modern technology, it was too much for me, man. Yeah. I needed to be simplified. I needed to see myself doing right. And then that's all I really need to see.
And, you know, on this topic of, you know, pitching and, you know, just going with your gut, the pitcher-catcher relationship, I'm curious for you. I mean, is that something that, you know, especially nowadays, you know, a lot of guys and, you know, a lot of managers and, you know, people outside the game, like analysts, you know, always say that, you know, the pitcher-catcher relationship and, you know, they're looking at, you know, their starts with, you know, one guy compared to another and, you know, maybe making kind of excuses in terms of, you know, maybe, you know, not being as comfortable. Is that something that you found that, you know, your comfortable, you know, level obviously helped you or didn't help you just in the fact of, you know, maybe, you know, having a spot start with a catcher and just, you know, going through that? I mean, or were you comfortable with, you know, the majority of the guys, you know, matter the experience.
I got spoiled, man. I got some good ones from day one. I mean, even the stuff in New York, I mean, you look back at the beginning of that year and me and George had some great games, you know, so it wasn't like it was just a bad relationship. I just think it got to the point where I didn't know if I should throw this and he didn't know if he should put that down, you know, and then it was like, you know, Jorge's stubborn, you know, I'm stubborn, and it was just one of those things. But you know, I was looking back at it the other day, and I'm like, man, even for my first game, you know, we came into Baltimore as a Yankee. You know, he caught that game and got that first W, you know. So I was full from day one. You know, I had Redmond, who was a great framer, CJ, who called a good game, to Paul LaDuca, he was a good catcher. And then I got Russell Martin and Rod Brahoff and Cervelli and Jorge and Molina. I mean, he was the one of Molina brother, you know. So it was just Benji, I forgot, had his brother in Toronto. So I've been lucky, you know. And I think I'm a challenge for anybody, especially myself, but I can imagine for a catcher. So I respected everybody that I threw with and everybody I worked with, because I know it couldn't have been easy.
Yeah, and you know, I'm curious for you, also, you know, going through all these different, you know, teams and, you know, stadiums and stuff. I mean, for you, you know, being a young kid, obviously, you know, being traded to the Marlins, but, you know, picking, you know, these other cities. I mean, for you, I'm sure, you know, having a family, but also, you know, wanting to, you know, get a good fit. I mean, how much time and effort did you put into it, you know, going into an off season, you know, where you had the opportunity to sign with a team like New York? Or, you know, just, you know, going back to Pittsburgh. How much time did you put into that aspect of, you know, making sure it was the right fit for not only you, but for your family, you know, going into a season?
Right. Well, Toronto took a little bit. New York was pretty quick. Philly took a little bit, and Pittsburgh was really quick. So Toronto took a little bit because, you know, it's different. It's a way. Had to make sure, you know, kids being young, family working out, how's that going to be being up north? New York was really quick. I mean, because of my 08 season, you know, I had a really good 08 season against them. So they came at me really quick, and it was just, you know, it was a no-brainer on that one. And Philly was took a little bit of time because just wanted to see where Pittsburgh was at the time. And it was a good fit with Philly because of, you know, the guys I knew, from, like I said, growing up. Wasn't my best year ever, but you know what? That stuff happens. Yeah. And but it's an hour away from my house, you know, so I'm then again close to home. And then I realized, you know, halfway through going away the season, where I needed to be, and again nothing against Philly. But you know, you feel in your gut and you know things. So I think it was 3-4 days after the season, I think, I signed back with Pittsburgh. So that one was really quick. But I mean, a lot comes to it. You're right. Your family's number one. I mean, they got to be comfortable. You got to be comfortable away, because that's the majority of your career is just going to be away. So I got lucky with everyone that I picked. You know, I mean, I couldn't complain about an organization or a team.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, I just wanted to, you know, ask you, favorite city that, you know, you got to visit, you know, excluding, you know, the teams you played for, obviously, you know, having to be there, you know, for the majority of the season. But I mean, where's, you know, one city that, you know, you always look forward to on the calendar in terms of, you know, maybe just getting to see the scenery or just, you know, liking the stadium? I mean, is there anywhere specific that, you know, you enjoyed going to?
Well, I think early in my career, there was a handful of them, you know, just because I'm an Arkansas boy, haven't been traveling much, you know, never been to Cali, never been up east, northeast, you know, anywhere like that. So younger in my career, when I came to New York in the postseason, that was probably the ooh and the awe. Obviously, it's fun to go out to L.A. I'm a big Seattle fan. Like, I just love the weather there for some reason. I just think the stadium and the weather's really great. PNC at night. I have a few places that I enjoy. But, you know, it's, you know, you've been to one, you've been to them all. Yeah. You know what I mean? I hate to say it like that, but, you know, like I said, early in my career was more for that question, I think. And if I had to pick one, I mean, it'd probably have to be either New York or PNC, just from my own personal likes, you know, about those cities.
Yeah, and, you know, for you, you know, we talked a little bit about, you know, the clubhouse atmosphere. I mean, for you, I know you mentioned, you know, in 09 it was pretty, you know, significant and, you know, you guys all got along. But, you know, who, you know, just in the locker room, did you always, you know, look forward to, you know, maybe, you know, having fun with, you know, maybe joking around with, you know, I'm sure with all the pressure around you, you know, were there any specific guys that, you know, kind of, even if with yourself, you know, kind of joked around with and, you know, kind of brought that sense of, you know, being a little kid back to the game rather than, you know, always focusing on, you know, having to please, you know, the general manager, the manager, and, you know, more the professional stuff?
That's good, because it kind of went that way when I went from Toronto, New York, to Pittsburgh. So Doc was the guy in Toronto. So he was just a little quiet prankster, you know, and went about business. But if you did something to him, number one, wasn't going to forget. Number two, third same there, he had a retaliation for him, so you're just screwed either way. He was really fun to be around. And New York was the same way. You know, I told you, playing against those guys, you think they're straight, no fun having business guys. And that is true come game time, you know, at some points. But, you know, they're fun to joke around in the locker room as well. You know, you used to love seeing Alex and Robbie go at it, you know, and Mo go at it in New York. And then it got serious because, you know, you're real serious, you know, and then going to Pittsburgh, they were all young guys. So I couldn't walk 2 feet in there without them yelling at me or doing something to me, you know, messing with the old guy because they were just all young guys at the time. So it was different everywhere I went, but I was kind of that guy. You know, I like to loosen it up, I like to have fun, but at the same time, you got to know when it's time to get serious and when not.
Yeah, and for you, you know, being, you know, obviously, you know, in 99, I'm sure, you know, you were more of a prankster and, you know, just, you know, being a young kid. But, you know, ending in 2015, I mean, did you ever, you know, change kind of your mentality, you know, even in the locker room, you know, having to, you know, maybe be, you know, one of the guys the younger guys looked at? Or were you always just, you know, comfortable and relaxed in the sense of, you know, joking around with everyone rather than, you know, making sure, you know, you were more of kind of the leadership and, you know, maybe being a little too, you know, professional and, you know, giving them the wrong kind of opinion of, you know, what baseball in the major leagues is about.
Right. I was fun and young, obviously, in the Florida, Toronto days. I think as my career got older, I didn't really stop the joking around and stuff like that. But I did it in maybe different ways, you know, to make a point to guys. You know, I was a veteran guy that was hard on some guys, but I wasn't like crazy hard on them. You know, I tried to make it where you knew I was being serious, but at the same time, I got half a smile going. You know what I mean? So it changed as I got older. I think younger, I was just a young kid in the big leagues, and it was just, yeah, it was awesome. You don't really know your purpose until you've been there and you fought some battles and went through it. And then you find your purpose in the game, and that's when it came out later in my career to be that leader that I never thought I would be. And I was, and that's why I thank Doc and the guys in New York that I was able to play with. You know, Andy was to the left of me, and Jeter was a locker and a half to the right of me. And to have those guys to watch and learn from made a huge impact on me going to Pittsburgh. So I still stayed on them. I still joked a little bit, but I think it changed a little more serious toward the end just because I knew I had to be an example more than a kid, you know, a kister.
Now, what was your favorite prank throughout all the years? I mean, is there one that stands out for you? We've had some other guys, you know, say some pretty cool pranks. I mean, what's one that maybe, you know, sticks out to you in terms of, you know, the best reaction or, you know, one that you were really looking forward to?
Well, I hate to say it, but it was done to me.
Wow.
You know, this was my Toronto. It was Ted Lilly, good old Teddy. We were sitting, you know, Oakland's got the on-deck circle where the players can kind of stand by the on-deck circle, and then there's the dugout. So Teddy and the head coach lean up against that, and I'm kind of just standing in the back. I don't remember the next to BJ or Downs, you know, I don't remember. And I had sunflower seeds and gum and everything else in my mouth, so I was just constantly spitting on Teddy. Like, not like all over, but on the back of his leg, like knee down, just a little bit here and there, just to get a reaction out of him, because Teddy was a big jokester. He was fun to be around. So he disappears for a couple of innings and comes back out. And you know, we're just sitting on the bench talking, you know, like nothing ever happened. And I go upstairs after the game and I go in my locker and my boxers are soaking wet. So I'm like, oh, okay, you got me. I got no underwear to wear home. Good one, Teddy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, you know, ha-ha. So I get dressed, you know, just throw my jeans on, get on the bus. And we're on the way back to the hotel, man. I'm starting to get a little hot, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm starting to feel a little bit of temperature. And I hear some snickering going on in the back, and I'm like, I got to put two and two together here, right? So Teddy had put Red Hot on my jeans. So soaking the underwear was just to get me to go throw my jeans on again,
yeah,
on the bus real quick. And then next thing you know, I'm on fire down low on the bus, and they're just back there horse laughing. And that was probably the best one that I've had happen to me. And as far as me pranking people, I don't think I did a lot of pranking. You know, I did the pies and I would do little things here and there. But as far as that kind of prank, that was probably the best one that's ever done to me. Because that was a warm bus ride home.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, I wasn't expecting that. And, you know, just for you, you know, I kind of just wanted to wrap up because, you know, it's been, I believe, almost like a half hour. And, you know, that's what we told you. For you, I mean, just, you know, what have you been up to now, you know, outside of the game? I know you got, you know, your family. I know it seems like you're big in the quadding, if that's true or not. And, you know, just how much, you know, do you keep in touch with some of the guys that you were close with? I mean, what's been going on with you, you know, ever since you retired?
Miss it. I'm not gonna lie. Not sure if I'm regretting leaving the game now with everything that's going on right now, but I keep in touch with my friends and the guys that I'm a fan of. Yes, I'm still a fan of baseball. I'm still a fan of some guys that I played with. So I keep in touch with those guys here and there. I'm up every morning with the kiddo every other morning, so I do keep in. I'm in the loop. You know, I'm on TV. And internet, you know, just try to stay in the loop just in case I ever do get back in the game. I don't want to be too far, you know, too far out. But yeah, I'm huge in the quads. I always kind of was, but you know, as a player, you got to take it easy. Last thing you got to do is get hurt, you know, doing some stuff like that. But I've had a huge welcome in the off-road community, and it's, I've met a lot of good friends, a lot of good relationships doing that, traveling around, running these machines, building them. I mean, heck, I don't even know what a carburetor was when I was playing baseball. You know, now I can take one apart and rebuild it. But I'm enjoying being here. My oldest son's at Coastal right now, Carolina, and we're taking trips to visit him and enjoying it down there, teaching my youngest how to drive. So my hands are still full, you know, three dogs and that mom. So taking it day by day, and like I said, just maybe one day we get back in it and see what it's all about.
So in terms of, you know, your playing career, are you – then retired, or you know, maybe are you trying to get into coaching? I mean, is there a chance, say, if a team came to you, you know, maybe there's an injury and they said 1 year, you know, finish out the season for $20 million to go pitch for the Yankees? Is that something that maybe would entice you?
Can I roll the ball to home plate, or do I gotta throw it?
Do you have to what?
Can I roll it to home plate, or do I have to throw it? Because I've been a couple years, man, through baseball, so I don't know if I could do that. I don't know. My career as a player is over. And I think, Kyle, I think that's why I haven't been back to spring training yet, because I'm scared I'll get there and still feel like I can do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't want to be that guy. Like, I want to make sure I know I can't play, which I know I can't now, but I'm just saying, back a couple of years ago, I want to make sure that I didn't go there and tremendously, tremendously miss it and try to get back on the mound and do something stupid. So I'm at the point now where, you know, I've had a beat-up leg for the past year and a half, dealing with some knee issues. And like I said, I ain't throwing baseball in 22 and a half years. But, hey, somebody came to me that offer, Kyle, I'm going to throw as hard as I can.
That's what I'm saying, yeah.
I'm just telling you. But I wouldn't mind getting back in it, you know, eventually one day. I think there's a lot of knowledge that I've learned over my career that I could get off my chest and throw it on to somebody else, and maybe they can learn from it and just try to help guys. You know, I realized that later in my career that that's what I was there for. Yes, I'm there to pitch. Yes, that's my job. But I was there to you know, embrace these young kids, show them things, and give every little bit of my knowledge to them. And they take what they want, and they leave what they want. But I think that's more important to my legacy or anybody else's legacy is what you left in the game, not exactly what you did, but hey man, he helped these kids. You know, he was all about that. Yes, he went about his business, but I think I have a knowledge, and I have a way with some of the younger guys that I think maybe eventually that I'll get back.
Cool.
We'll see.
Yeah,
I've been close the past couple of years. I've been in discussions here and there, but just not really 100% sold in yet. So just enjoying my family time.
Yeah. So, you know, just thanks for coming on. You know, we'll keep in, you know, looking out for, you know, maybe an offer like that coming out to you, you know, for big money.
Yeah, well,
for
hey,
1 year.
I don't have an agent, so you make it happen. We'll have to make some kind of deal here.
All right. Yeah. We'll keep.
And I appreciate you, Kyle. I know I beat around the bush for a couple months, and you were very professional about it. So I really appreciate you not hanging up on me and giving me the time to come on your podcast, bro.
No, yeah, thanks for coming on. I know you're busy and everything, so, you know, it was great to talk to you for a little bit. You know, wish you and, you know, the family all the best, and, you know, just thanks for coming on.
You got it. Hit me up anytime you need anything, but appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
You got it.
Yeah, so that was AJ Burnett coming on the podcast. You know, obviously, you know, winning the World Series in 09, didn't really want to touch on that too much because, you know, I'm expecting that, you know, 09, you know, AJ and them, you know, I'm sure it was just going to be, you know, pretty cool kind of atmosphere for them that, you know, maybe can't even be explained, you know, winning that, you know, touching on that a little bit, but, you know, not getting too much into that, you know, just more of the career aspect. Great to talk to AJ. You know, hope he gets back into the game when he wants to. I'm sure there's always a spot for him, just based on his career and everything. So, you know, just thanks for listening to AJ and me talk about all of his career and all of his kind of attributes and, you know, memories about the game. 17 years in the pros. Obviously, there's going to be a lot of stuff to talk about that we didn't even get to touch upon. But, you know, just thanks for him to coming on. You know, very awesome to, you know, get someone of his caliber on the show. And, you know, thanks for listening to